The Communal Socialists. One of the persistent fallacies that continues to plague us in this country is the assumption that communism and or socialism is a Russian product, or possibly a European or even an Asiatic product, that it is an import and that it has been somehow brought to us from abroad. In actual fact, I suppose you could say everything in our society has come from abroad, since ours is a transplanted culture from Europe. But it is important to realize that theories relating to communism and socialism antedate Marx by hundreds of years. Marx didn't invent them, and the current movements in China and Russia and elsewhere have not been responsible for bringing those ideas to these shores. On the contrary, we have had some of those ideas and developed them here long before they appeared in their present forms in Europe and Asia. The concept of anarchy, which really got underway in the latter half of the 18th century, is not the first evidence of practical socialism that we've had in the country. Anarchy came into being as other 18th century socialism came into being as a well-organized body of socialist thought. But prior to the organizing of a body of thought, we had actually began in this country to pioneer socialist experimentations, and communal socialists were among the very first in this country to experiment in this area. For instance, Jamestown, a colony founded in Virginia in 1607 during the reign of James I of England, was a commune. It was set up that way deliberately because it was believed that that was the most expeditious way of getting a colony started. Private ownership of property was not tolerated. Everything was done for the common good. And, of course, if you didn't work, you didn't eat. You had to work not for yourself, but for the commune. That was the theory involved. The Plymouth Colony, founded in 1620 in Massachusetts, was another case in point. If you'd like to read a very good account of what happened at Plymouth Colony, may I recommend the diary of Governor Bradford, who explained how they had set everything up based upon Plato's ideas and the idea that everyone should have according to his need, and everyone should work for the general store, and so on. And, of course, the whole idea was an impractical one, and the colony went through a very, very severe 18, 19, or 20 months, at which time the governor went back on that idea and introduced the idea of private ownership of property, saying that anybody could have anything that he was himself willing to produce. And from that moment on, the Plymouth Colony flourished, or began to flourish. The Massachusetts Bay Colony, another colony established in the New World, was likewise a commune at the outset. Now, these are not anarchistic communes or communistic communes per se, because the founders of anarchy as a social theory and the founders of communism as social theory had not yet been born. But nonetheless, these are practicing communes in which the ideas of private ownership of property are removed, and the general thought is that everybody is there working for the social whole, and everybody receives as he needs something, but he converts all his ability to the common good, whatever that may mean. Now, those are only some of the beginnings. We had other communal socialist groups getting started in the early colonial days, and even immediately thereafter, we had the same type of commune getting started. But here is one of the characteristics we find in all of the communal socialists. These are experimenters, primarily. They are not social theorists so much as they are practically trying to put the pieces together in a small or on a small scale. The theorists wanted to remake the world. Anarchists, communists, and socialists generally want to change the face of the earth. The communal socialists wanted to create a little commune wherein everything would be peace and light and joy and beauty, and never mind the rest of the world. And this you will find as the dominant characteristic of the communal socialists who began in this country from the very first colonies and who continue to flourish right up to the present time. We have a number of such colonies still in existence in these United States. I'd like to mention a few of those that have attained to some degree of prominence and some degree of notoriety down through the years beyond our first founding colonies. For instance, during the 19th century, Robert Owen, a British textile mill owner, founded a movement which took his name. His followers were called Owenites, and he picked up some ideas from Proudhon relating to profit sharing, and he finally founded a colony in New Harmony, Indiana, which was supposed to be based on the idea of profit sharing. His colony failed. Then there was a man named Rapp, R-A-P-P, who had a kind of a religious socialist view, and his followers are called Rappites. And for a while, he operated New Harmony colony. The New Harmony colony also influenced a great many people, such as Josiah Warren, who was one of America's earliest anarchists, helped to convince him both that communal living was a good, and then when New Harmony failed, that communal living was not a good. But in any case, New Harmony, Indiana, was one of the great communes that we had in this country, and it was founded at a very early time, and it had several efforts to make it into a collectivized communal type of society. All of them failed, and it ultimately converted to the more or less standard semi-private property, private capitalism that you'll find is standard in the country. There was a very famous commune that got started in New England called Brook Farm. This was founded by a group of transcendentalists. It's a religious group in a sense. That is, it's fundamentally theological, but not Christian. It is it advocates new thought in religious theory, and a number of the people who became active with Brook Farm were some of America's leading intellectuals. Theoretically, Brook Farm was supposed to be a place where all these intellectuals would go so that they could have endless hours of discussion in their theories and that they would all share in the work. However, when they got there, they certainly enjoyed their discussions, but they didn't want to do the work, and so they began hiring people to do the work for them, and that, of course, broke up the whole idea. They never did really carry it out. And finally, Brook Farm burned, and they decided not to put in the money to repair it or to buy another one. So Brook Farm was a very short-lived success, but it's very well known. And if you haven't read up on it, there is a book out, I think, by that name, Brook Farm, and it's well worth your examination. Another colony in upstate New York that got founded along communal socialist lines was the Oneida Colony. This was put together by a group of atheists. Nonetheless, they were very good workers, and they were silversmiths, and they specialized in working. And, of course, this is one of the key factors of anything. If people will work at it, sometimes it works out. And the Oneida Colony was a success, but it ultimately converted to capitalism because the colony made so much money that the members of it had nothing. And so, realizing that they had created the wealth, why, they ultimately converted to capitalism. And as a matter of fact, that's where our Oneida silver comes from today. It's from the spinoff from the earlier Oneida Colony. Another colony of similar origins was the famous Almanac Colony near Cedar Rapids in Iowa. This one was started nearly 200 years ago. It isn't quite that old, but it was put together by a devoutly religious group, and they decided to be farmers and to and simply to live without anybody owning anything, but everything would be shared, each as he had need. They took as their theme the ideas that you'll find in scriptures in the book of Acts, where it's described how after the crucifixion of Jesus, the early Christians got together and lived communally, waiting for the second coming. And they thought that this is what they should do. And they're very, very fine, highly moral, peaceful people. And it also worked out that they were very productive. They got about 25,000 acres of the best farmland in Iowa, and it became a very successful colony, not on the basis of their beliefs, but on the basis of their efforts. And it lasted as a commune for better than 100 years, about 130 years, I believe. And then it converted to a co-op, and a little later it converted to full stock capitalism. And I think only a short while ago, possibly in 1967 or 68, maybe 66, the Amana colony was sold to Raytheon. And, of course, this is the place where you get your Amana freezers and Amana blankets and Amana furniture. It was originally made by these communal socialists living there, but it is now made by a stock company that is a private enterprise company. Another very interesting group of communal socialists would be the Hutterites. These are religious people, devoutly Christian, who have colonies in both North and South Dakota, and but primarily in Canada and elsewhere along the Canadian border on this side of the line. The Hutterites are totally communal to this day. They have been in existence as a colony, not in this country, but as a group, I should say. They've been in existence for better than 400 years, and they are continuing to operate much as they did 400 years ago. No one in the commune owns anything at all. The women live in their barracks, the men in their own, and they're very devout. They pray at intervals all during the day, and we never hear of the Hutterites getting into any trouble outside of their communes, and what happens in the communes is not really known too much. I had a student of mine go there and live with them for a while and wrote a very good article about them, and he reported that they were among the most devout people he'd ever seen in his life. They don't cause any problems unless it's to themselves, and they operate in this communal way in which even the individuals don't own their own clothing, including the women. They simply hang their dresses in a communal cloakroom at night, and they go there and put on a dress in the morning. Apparently, the dresses are of such general shape and size that it wouldn't really matter which dress you had on, and apparently it works out the same way for the men. It's all right if you like it, and apparently they do. These people are no problem to anyone, as I've indicated. Another even more interesting group that is somewhat parallel to the Hutterites would be the Dukhobors. This is a Russian group that occupies much the same part of the United States and Canada. Their colonies would be in the same general area. And although they haven't been around quite as long as the Hutterites, they have tended to make an even more dramatic impact on society because they seem to have an economic practice that has gotten them no end of notoriety. It seems that when they're all producers, these people. These are farming communes where the people believe in hand labor. They don't use modern tools or modern equipment such as tractors. They use pitchforks and spades and hoes and things of this sort, and they work directly with the soil. And again, we have a very devout group in the Dukhobors. Characteristically, the Dukhobors do not bother with English or French. Although they are primarily in Canada and could use either language, they insist on speaking Russian, and they are Russian Christians who fled Russia a long time ago. Some of them are doubtless still in Russia in rural areas, but they practice their Christianity, and they practice this kind of hand labor on the farm even today, and they do very well. They're good dirt farmers. The result is that they raise good crops. And when they want to sell their crops, they find out what the price, the going price, is in the market, and then they almost invariably insist on selling it below the market price. That is to say, just characteristically, if potatoes are selling at $1 a bushel, they will sell for 90 cents a bushel. And they have very good potatoes, and consequently they will sell all their potatoes, and the other producers of potatoes will be angry with them because they will be cutting the market price. Conversely, when the Duke of Bohrs wish to buy something, and keep in mind now that they buy not as individuals, and they don't sell as individuals, this is the whole colony acting, when the Duke of Bohrs wish to buy land or whatever else they want to buy, they find out what the going price is. Let's suppose that land is selling at $40 an acre. Well, they may pay $45 an acre. When they go to the market, they pay a little more than the going price. The consequence is that everyone who has anything to sell is very anxious to see if he can't sell it to the Duke of Bohrs. And the result of this is, of course, that the local business people are constantly distressed with the Duke of Bohrs because the Duke of Bohrs get the best of everything. And once in a while, they decide to pass laws to prohibit people from dealing with them. When this happens, and here's how the Duke of Bohrs have gotten their reputation, there's a when there's a public meeting where the Duke of Bohrs are going to be discussed, these people from this commune will attend and sit there in stolid, stony silence. They don't understand the language anyway, but there is an interpreter who is more or less the manager of the group, and he is capable of hearing what is going on, but they all listen. And when their leader gives them a sign indicating that a motion has been carried against them or some such thing, they have a distinct way of protesting. They simply stand up and divest themselves of all their garments right then and there and stand forth in the public meeting in the nude. The second step of their protest is to go outside and have a parade while they're still in the nude. And I might point out that this has happened in 20 degree below zero weather, in the midst of a snowstorm. You can find the Duke of Bohrs marching down Main Street without a stitch on. They seem to have the courage of their convictions, although I dare say their convictions cause cold chills in others, even if it doesn't in them. And then there's a third step to their protest, having publicly shown their lack of respect for the action taken. They then go back and they burn out their own farms. They set fire to their houses and their crops, and they burn the whole thing and leave a scorched earth behind them and move on. I think one time they inadvertently burned some property not their own, and they were very happy to make recompense there, I understand. Their intent is not to harm anyone, but simply to show their disdain and their disapproval when anybody passes laws against them. And they've operated this way for a very long time. They're very devout people, and they don't cause any problems to others except in this economic pinch that they seem to institute. We don't find criminals coming from their group, but this is their general nature. Now, we've had a number of other types of organizations. There's we don't hear very much of this anymore, but in the 19th century, we had a good number of colonies started in this country by the Fourier Society of France. Greeley, Colorado was just such a commune established by the Fourier Society. One of the characteristics of the Fouriers is that they believe in free love and also are quite happy to practice nudity. There seems to be sort of an affiliation for free love and nudity coming from both the communal socialist groups in some cases and from anarchist groups in some cases. This is where we get some of that. The Fourier Society, of course, took the name Greeley, Colorado, in honor of Horace Greeley, who was the publisher of the New York Tribune, which was the paper that, you may recall, was carrying Karl Marx as a columnist for a couple of years. I think about the only steady employment that Marx ever had as a columnist. There are other groups, too, that are worthy of mention that we've had in the past. There have been any number of communes set up called Zion. Now, these are not Jewish communes. They are just called Zion in a biblical sense, and there have been at least half a dozen of them. There was a one time, and they may still be in existence, I haven't checked this, the House of David, a very prominent commune. The members of it were males, and they were famous for their beards and their basketball or baseball, and apparently very fine people, religiously oriented. Another group that is religiously oriented would be the Shakers, which was an outcropping of the Quakers. In this case, the Shakers took the position that absolute purity must accompany all their members. There was to be no relationship between the sexes. And the result is, of course, and these people were quite sincere and devout, their colony has tended to die out. The last I heard, there were two or three very, very old ladies, the last remnants of the colony, and no one else is around, and apparently they were not able to attract very many young people into their movement. There is, of course, the tendency that many people have of listing the Mormons and the Amish or the Mennonites as communal socialists, and in a sense, but only in a sense, is that true. These people believed in a kind of communal living and a kind of communal responsibility, that is, a sharing among themselves of community interests. But they also, at the same time, believed very strongly in private ownership of property. And so they would not fall specifically into the socialist category, which invariably takes this old idea that the what should be done is the abolition of private ownership of property. So only in a sense could you find those people to be communists or socialists. They really aren't. They simply believe in a very strong emphasis by individuals, and mostly on a voluntary basis, to take the responsibility for the community at large without having the government do it, but doing it themselves, but on a voluntary basis, and meanwhile, they own property privately. Currently, of course, we have quite a number of neo-communes springing up all over the country. It happens all the time, but right now we're having a plethora of it on various campuses. There are really two types of communes that now are cropping up on various campuses, and one of them is kind of a free enterprise commune, and the other is definitely communistically a commune. In the former, what happens is a group of students will possibly take a lease on a large home, and somebody will manage it like a guest house or a hotel, and everybody that comes in will pay a commensurate fee for staying there, and private property is respected. But there usually is a kind of sexual permissiveness in these affairs that gives them a sexual communal relationship. That is to say, the students tend to play musical beds, but aside from that, they are private enterprise operations. And then, of course, there are the other type, the communistic communes that are set up, that are where somebody often will make a gift of a lease or a piece of land or a building, often a run-down building, to these people, where they won't even have to pay any rent. And then the people who go in there simply share and share alike whatever it is they have. Everyone has a crack at, and they operate that way. In addition to this, of course, we have various communes being organized off campus. We usually think of them as hippie communes. Those are the successor to the old hobo jungles that used to be around in the in this country in the 20s and 30s. We now have hippie communes, the one characteristic primarily differentiating the hobo jungle from the hippie commune would be the advent of the ladies. Very, very few hobo jungles had any of the fair sex present, and the hippie communes are notable for having men and women both in profusion, as well as children. So you have those hippie communes and the campus communes coming along today, and they're quite popular, and I wouldn't have any idea as to how many are in existence at the present time. The students seem to run through a kind of phase here. They become very enthusiastic for communal type living, and they live this way for a while. But most of them seem to go through this as a period, and then it phases out, and they leave. But others come in, so the commune is sustained. In general, as we consider all of these experiments, and I've only named a few, there are many, many more, there have been over 100 different kinds of socialist communes or communistic socialists organized in this country right from the beginning at Jamestown on to the present time. The general characteristic has been this. There are three outcomes, one or another of these three results ultimately overtake these communes. First, they fail. Now, there's been a large incidence of failure among these particular type of activities. Or, if they don't fail, a great many of them convert to private ownership of property, like the Amanas, for instance, who found that the colony was very, very wealthy, and yet the members of the colony were living in abject poverty, and ultimately they became tired of that kind of an arrangement because these people worked very, very hard and they were getting no reward for it except the intangible reward of feeling a kind of satisfaction that they were so engaged. And they ultimately converted to private property and to private capitalism. Or there is a third outcome. In those instances where there has been a very profound religious influence, it is apparently possible for a commune to be established and to continue almost indefinitely. Certainly those that are the longest-lived are those that have a religious core around which the mentalities of the members go into orbit. And that seems to be the general characteristic of the American communal socialists. Don't think for a minute that these ideas were started by Marx or have been imported from other countries. We have done a great deal of experimentation here and have actually exported many of these ideas abroad. Thank you.